A huge thank you goes out to NordVPN for their continued support of Name Explain. A VPN is an essential for any web browsing device, and Nord's simplicity, security, and speed makes it the best VPN I've ever used. Having NordVPN on your device will make sure your connection is safe and secure, and that no one unexpected will be able to access your data. It will also allow you to bypass geographic restrictions that might be present on the web in your part of the world, such as content on various streaming services, and of course, entire websites and a certain app that might not be available in your country. Viewers of Name Explain can get 68% off a 2-year plan and one extra month for free by visiting nordvpn.com/nameexplain and by using the code nameexplain, which will all be linked down below. Thank you to Nord for sponsoring the show, and once again, that's nordvpn.com/nameexplain and code nameexplain. It seems that there's one form of life that is by and large evaded being talked about too much here on Name Explain. We've looked into the names of people, places, and other animals here on the channel, but it seems an entire kingdom of life hasn't been that celebrated here, that being the plant kingdom. While yes, we have a few videos dealing with fruit, from the pineapple slash ananas debate, what was called orange first, and even a very old video looking into the names of apples, that's about it in regard to plants, and this is just absolutely crazy to myself. Plants are all around us, are essential to life on this planet, so today I want to make up for the years of snubbing I've given the plant kingdom. Let's celebrate the planet's plants. And specifically, the planet's prettiest plants, those of course being flowers. Flowers seem to be a thing in pretty much all cultures of society, and it's easy to see why. A lot of the colours and shapes we see in flowers rarely appear anywhere else in nature, and their enjoyable smell makes them beloved by many. They become the go-to, timeless gift for pretty much any occasion, from roses on Valentine's Day to lilies at a funeral. There are few events on earth in which someone getting flowers would seem odd. They're used in celebration and in sympathy. It's quite remarkable how flowers can fit into pretty much any social situation when you think about it. But flowers' importance don't just stem from human-made society. Plants play a huge role in the natural world too. They serve as a food source for many animals, most notably bees enjoying their nectar, and bees pretty much keep the world ticking over, well, if this film taught me anything anyway. And there are no lack of types of flowers on our planet. There are believed to be around 400,000 different kinds of flowering plants on Earth, so this definitely wouldn't be a comprehensive list of how every flower got its name, but rather I want to focus on some of the more popular flowers we all know of, and some of the lesser-known flowers which still have rather striking names, as the world of flower names is far more interesting than you might think, and some flowers have rather fun, fascinating, and even foul etymologies. Yet, before we look into the names of specific flowers, where did that word even come from? And what even is a flower exactly? By no surprise, flower is a pretty ancient word. It comes from the Old French flore, which means a plethora of things, from stuff we relate more with flowers like blossom, to other words like heyday and prime, and even things like innocence and virginity. It makes sense as to why it would mean things like prime slash heyday, as when a plant has flowered, that's seen as being a peak of its lifespan. And flowers have always been connected with things like virginity and innocence, so that explains those meanings too. But why exactly do plants have flowers? What's the point of them other than to look pretty? Well, the flower of a plant is actually the reproductive area of a plant. Everything for a plant to create more plants is located within its flowers, and sometimes plants need a helping hand to reproduce, which is where pollinating animals like bees come into play. The reason many flowers have such pretty petals is so they can attract animals to help them out in reproduction. And while we have a certain image of what exactly a flower is, way more things are actually secretly flowers too. Broccoli is actually a cluster of flower buds that haven't blossomed yet, and so is cauliflower, which makes more sense if I actually look at its name. Likewise with artichokes too, they're actually thistle-like flowers a week before they bloom too. And a lot of plants we don't usually link with flowers do actually flower too, like cacti and other succulents. Anyway, onto the names of these flowers, starting off with a personal favourite of mine, the daisy. These are perhaps the atypical kind of flower, at least in appearance anyway. If people think of a flower, they're most likely thinking of something along the lines of a daisy. Like most flowers and life on the planet in general, they adore the sun. So much in fact that when the sun isn't out, they close up all their petals. It's due to this praising of the sun as to where the name comes from. When a daisy is open during the daytime, it looks rather like an eye, well, an abstract cartoon eye anyway. It's an eye for the day. The day's eye. Day's eye. Yep, the word daisy comes from Old English and means exactly that, day's eye, due to their shape and love of the daylight. Next up, we have a flower with a rather unique name of forget-me-not, which might be the only flower to have a demand as its name. These light blue flowers seem very tied with romance and are given in hope that the receiver will, well, never forget who gave them to them. I've read loads of different ideas as to where this name comes from. One legend is that a knight gave these flowers to his lady love, but shortly fell into the river and sunk due to his heavy armor. Before meeting his end, he apparently shouted, "Forget-me-not," and the demand was bestowed upon the flower's name. I've also read that in Christian legend, the flowers were created by a young Jesus, in hope the flower would remind his followers of him. Whether these legends are true, who knows, but the flower first picked up the name in Old French, and since then it hasn't been forgotten. Their fancy Greek name is Myosotis, which means mouse's ear, as their petals are thought to look like the ears of the rodent. The tulip is a flower heavily linked to one nation in particular, the wonderful country of the Netherlands. It's hard to go admitting in any of the Netherlands' tourist destinations without seeing a tulip or 10. People visit from around the globe to see their field upon field of brightly coloured tulips. A period of Dutch history is even known as Tulip Mania. That's how important a role they play in the nation. However, the name isn't actually of Dutch origin. It actually comes from the Turkish language, with their word of tulabent, with this word meaning turban. This is because tulips are seen as having a resemblance to turbans, which now that you've mentioned it, I can actually see. Another flower that acquired its name due to what it resembles is the orchid. Orchids are colourful and abundant, so it's no surprise to see they're so popular across the world. They're thought to be some of the oldest flowers on the planet, and they actually take the award of the tiniest seeds in the world. Though perhaps people wouldn't be as fond of orchids if they found out where their name comes from. The name comes from the Greek orchis, which means testicle. It's definitely a name that contrasts the dainty image these flowers have. But why do they have this name? As I said, it relates to their appearance. Do you have to dig a little deeper, quite literally in this case, to spot anything resembling the shape of a man's private area? In their roots, orchids have tubers which store energy for the flower to use during the wet season when sunlight isn't as accessible. And it just so happens that these two tubers look like, well, see for yourself. And just when you thought your mind was out of the gutter, there's also a variant of orchids called naked old man orchids, cool so because their petals look exactly like that. So yes, the name of these flowers literally means a naked old man testicles. Not the best image, but hey, whatever you're into. The next flower I want to talk about is actually more commonly seen without its flowers. As from what I've read, making it blossom is quite the challenge. People can own them for years and never see it flower. Luckily, however, it does flower, which is great for us so we can talk about it in this video, because it has the intriguing name of mother-in-law's tongue. Mother-in-laws don't often get painted in the best light in human society. They can be seen as cruel, unpleasant, and rather sharp-tongued, and the leaves of this plant are rather sharp and kind of tongue-shaped, so these literal sharp tongues reminded people of the metaphoric sharp tongues of mother-in-laws, and the name stuck around. The flower has other names too, like St. George's sword and snake plant, which too all relate to the sharpness of the leaves. Carnations are a beloved flower too, and we aren't 100% sure as to where their name comes from, but as always, we have some fun ideas. One idea is that the name is a corruption of coronation, as the petals look somewhat like a crown, though another idea claims it might root from their pink colour, with the name coming from the Italian carnagione, meaning flesh-coloured, and this idea explains to us why it sounds like the word carnivore, which too relates to flesh. The name of foxglove, however, seems to offer all kinds of debate. It's such a unique name, and because of this, there seems to be many folk etymologies surrounding it. The classic story you hear often is the name comes from an old legend that fairies would tell foxes to put these flowers on their feet, like gloves on a hand, and it would help them be quieter. Of course, I doubt any fox has chosen to actually put the flower on any part of their limbs. Another theory relates to the fairies themselves wearing the flower, and that foxglove is a corruption of folk's glove, with folks being a name that was once upon a time applied to fairies. The fox in the name is thought to most likely relate to the German botanist Leonhard Fuchs, whose surname literally means fox in German. He gave it the scientific name of digitalis, which means finger, once again relating to the flower's shape and how it would snugly fit a finger in it. Leonhard Fuchs would actually also go on to have another flower named after him too, fuchsia, which is a tad more obvious. Peony flowers were very much known for their healing capabilities and were used in medicine often, and it's from this healing as to where the name for these flowers are thought to come from. The name peony may come from Greek mythology and their figure of Paean, the physician of the gods. Who would have thought that gods get sick too? Luckily, Paean was there to lend a hand, and his services were celebrated in the naming of this flower. Dandelion is a flower of a bad rap. It is in fact a flower, but a lot of people brandish it a weed. But they're actually a member of the daisy family, so they have the right to be called a flower, whether you see them as a weed or not. Their name comes from a very interesting origin. The humble dandelion is named after one of the deadliest parts or one of the most ferocious animals on our planet. The name is a corruption of the old French dandelion, which means lion's tooth. Now, lion's teeth are pretty darn scary. So why is this flower named after them? Well, once again, it's all to do with the shape. While the actual flower of a dandelion goes from yellow fluff to white puffball, the leaves of the flower are rather jagged and spiked, and do in fact look rather like the teeth of a lion. And finally, I want to end on the largest single flower that we know of, that being the Laphesia arnoldii. This huge flower is actually a parasite and lacks any roots, stem, or leaves. They are native to the islands of Sumatra and Borneo, and they are very odd indeed. The first part of this name comes from Sir Stamford Raffles, a British statesman who played a large role in this part of the world, including founding modern Singapore. The latter part of the name comes from English botanist Joseph Arnold, who first brought the flower to the attention of the West. The native name for the flower, however, was reported to be Petimum Sickenlily, which translated into meaning devil's betel box. A betel box is a box for holding betel, unsurprisingly, with betel being a type of leaf chewed in South Asian tradition. This particular name must come from its shape. But why does this betel box belong to the devil in particular? Well, I imagine that has to do with the smell of it. Raffalesia arnoldii gives off a horrific stench compared to rotting meat and decaying flesh. Because of this, the flower also goes by the less than pleasant name of corpse lily. And yes, it's Vileplume from Pokemon. Thank you to all my patrons who support Name Explain on a monthly basis. Patreon is vital to Name Explain, and donating just $2 a month allows you to enjoy ad-free videos and bonus patron-exclusive content. It also allows you to help choose what names get explained in upcoming videos, and gets your name here with all these awesome people. Thank you so much for all the support you guys give Name Explain. Hello all, and thank you so much for reaching the end of the video. Check out another video and subscribe to stay in the loop on all things Name Explain. You can find me on Twitter, I'm at NameExplainYT. On Instagram, I'm also NameExplainYT. And on Facebook, just search Name Explain. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video, and once again, thank you all so much.